So like there's a social aspect to that, which I'm still struggling to understand and to enact. Mm-hmm. So not only do we have like a haven for love, but also a haven for people. The ashram is alcohol free, so those who don't drink can come and hang out and have a great time with also people who don't drink, you know, and that it's a different environment, you know, so there's a lot of different layers, you know, to this environment that we're creating here.
So further than the yoga, do you guys also offer like retreat kind of?
Yes.
Yeah, this is
yeah.
A huge thing. Okay.
Yeah. And for individuals to come, we have a volunteer program. It's important to us that people aren't limited in their participation here by their economic situation, so we do our best to offer a spectrum of, you know, of available pricing according to what we can afford at any given time, which obviously changes.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes we can be more accommodative and sometimes not as much, but yeah. So yeah, we have volunteers coming from Help Us.
How long have you guys been running?
8 years.
Yeah, the ashram was founded in 2012. In April of 2012. Yeah. So anyway, like we basically have what little bush area that we have for habitat is continually being pushed in. So another thing that I'm doing to combat that a bit is leaving bush along my fence lines and bush along the property lines here. I think also in combination with the and having people come out, that also, you know, that participation also allows us to keep maintaining that. Mm-hmm. And that's what's, you know, I think really key for this area. Even though I have, on a number of occasions, appealed to both local and, government entities, you know, like the town council, the chairman, written letters to various departments of that I was recommended to by the chairman. And this is a number of years ago at this time. And the main response, you know, how it felt to me was honestly that there was a backlash against me personally for causing trouble. Mm-hmm. And the next time I went to go pay my water, I was threatened with a water meter, which, you know, I mean, that's neither here nor there in a way, you know. People get water meters, but all of a sudden, oh, we're going to come and meter your water. Oh, well, okay, why about, you know. I had some direct backlash, actually, from the chairman. He told me he didn't like having problems, and that if there was going to be problems, then there was going to be also problems for me. And he actually literally said these words to me at the end of the meeting that I had with the town council. And that meeting was generally regarding this area, how this area is unmonitored, how this area is used and possibly perceived as a place where you can go do whatever you want, mm-hmm. break bottles, drink, you know, and at the same time is also used a lot by families. So meantime, there's, you know, somebody goes down there and gets drunk and breaks some bottles, and the next people that come are people that have 5 babies. You know, and how are they going to, you know, this is not okay, this is just not all right. And it's the guys that have that vibe with the breaking the bottles that are kind of commandeering the area, which is really unfortunate. There's like around 2 o'clock every day, a big, super, super loud run of like 5 or 6 motorcycles that come up and down here. They're dirt bikes, they're super loud. You know, I know that's how they are and stuff. But you know, I have heard them not that loud, and you know, obviously I'm happy for the more community use that the area has, the more productive and important it is. You know,
showing them the carvings and the
right. Okay, so but this is an element that comes in, you know.
Yeah.
Now, I do have to tell you that there is a reason why the chopping happens. And that's because at points where it's very slippery, the boys want to play. They run around all over that thing like a wild jungle gym. You can't, it's incredible. You'd be blown away. You'd be like, wow. You know, how are these guys moving like this? How are they clinging to there, you know? And up the trees and off the trees and, you know, all kinds of stuff going on. But they will chop a little bit just to open, take the slippery part off. And I understand that, you know, but that's different than, you know, creating graffiti all over the place and carving in your name and, you know, I mean, I understand when somebody, you know, wants to do it. But all of this seems really big in the culture here. I don't really understand, like that's hard for me to, it's just really hard for me to relate to that headspace because, you know, I'm from Canada, we, you know, there's generally like you're raised kind of to treasure and respect the wild areas because that's, we have so much of that where I come from. And I myself also was a licensed park guide for Parks Canada. In my youth as well.
Where are you from in Canada?
I come from Winnipeg, Manitoba, and so does Evan.
Oh, I come from Mississauga.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. So, you know, you understand that, right? Like there's an, you know, sort of an ingrained cultural need for that mm-hmm. kind of respect and a feeling like this is for, you know, ourselves, it's for the wildlife. If we have to stand up against the government, sometimes we do, you know, people go for it, they take it seriously, and that's kind of an aspect that's missing from here, so understanding how to engender that, how to create that.
You mentioned getting some backlash from the town council, why?
For causing a situation where a meeting